Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
You are all already quiet. It's wild. It's like a, I don't know, something that's never happened before. First time for everything. Welcome to worship. It's so good to be with all of you. A couple of things this morning. So after some number of years, I have no idea how many years, we're going to be using some of the liturgy from the GHB liturgical form. We've been using these, well, someone's excited. I'm excited too. We've been using these songs for a long time, as long as I've been here at least, but we haven't used this this liturgy, so I'm excited to have Joel lead us singing. I'm not sure my voice would carry throughout. We'll have it up there though, but just bear with us. It'll be a little different for me and these lovely folks. Other announcements this morning.
Happy Father's Day, Dad.
I don't remember the moms getting an ovation.
Well, I really could say it.
True. Other announcements this morning. Yeah. With handshakes today. I'll just do this or wave at you. But I tested this morning. It's not COVID. My wife is tested too. We don't have COVID. It's just a bit of a bug. So just a heads up, I won't shake your hand, but it's not because I don't like you. I promise. Let's rise and worship God. Father of mercies and God of all consolation, come to the aid of your people today, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may attend to your word, confess our sins, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us together confess, make our confession. Almighty God, merciful Father, I confess to you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have offended you, and for which I justly deserve your punishment. But I am sorry for them, and repent of them, and pray for your boundless mercy, for the sake of the suffering and death of your
Children of God, hear the good news. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us. Through his Holy Spirit, God cleanses us and gives us power to proclaim the mighty deeds of God, who called us out of darkness and into the splendor of God's new light. God's gift of grace to us is the entire forgiveness of all of our sins. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
In the name of Christ our Maker, in the name of Christ our Redeemer, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Oh, come, let us worship our God. Oh, come, let us sing to our God. Let us shout for joy to the God of our salvation. Oh, come, let us worship our God. Oh, come, let us worship our God.
Be seated as we hear the word of God.
23-29. For Paul, baptism is a powerful bond that unites people, not only with God, but with other believers. Those who call themselves children of God experience a transformation that removes prejudices of race, social class, or gender in favor of true unity in Christ. Now, before faith came, we were imprisoned and guarded under the law until faith would be revealed. Therefore, the law was our disciplinarian until Christ came, so that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer subject to a disciplinarian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. And many of you, as were baptized into Christ, have clothed yourself with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male and female. For all of you are one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to their promise. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today is from chapter 22, verses 19 through 28, and we'll read it responsibly. But you, O Lord, be not far away. O my help, hasten to my aid.
Deliver me from the sword, my life, my power, and my love.
Save me from the lion's mouth, from the horns of wild bulls, you have rescued me.
I will declare your name to my people. In the midst of the assembly, I will praise you.
You who fear the Lord, give praise. All you of Jacob's line, give glory. Stand in awe of the Lord, all you offspring of Israel.
The Lord does not despise nor abhor the poor or the poverty. Neither is the Lord's face hidden from them, but when they cry out, the Lord hears them.
From you comes my praise in the great assembly. I will perform my vows in the sight of those who fear the Lord.
The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Let those who seek the Lord give praise. May your hearts live forever.
All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of nations shall bow before God.
For the dominion belongs to the Lord, who rules over the nations.
Jesus and his disciples arrived at the country of the Gerasenes, which is opposite Galilee. As Jesus stepped out on land, immediately a man of the city who had demons met him. For a long time, this man had worn no clothes, and he didn't live in a house, but rather in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he fell down before him and shouted at the top of his voice, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High?" Sorry, just a second. Can y'all hear me? I feel like I'm not being... You can hear me okay? Okay.
Yeah.
It's not coming through my ear for some reason. So, this man said, "I beg you, Jesus, Son of the Most High God, don't torment me." For Jesus had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man. Many times the demons seized him, and he was kept under guard and bound with chains and shackles, but he would sometimes break the bonds and be driven by the demons into the wilds. So Jesus then asked him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Legion," for many demons had entered him. And the demons begged him not to order them to go back into the abyss. Now there on the hillside, there was a large herd of swine that was feeding. And the demons begged Jesus to let them enter these. So he gave them permission. Then the demons came out of the man and entered the swine. rushed down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. Now when the swineherds saw what had happened, they ran off and told it in the city and in the country. Then people came out to see what had happened. And when they came to see Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. And the people were afraid. Those who had seen it told them how the one who had been possessed by many demons had been healed. Then all the people of the surrounding country of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them, for they were seized with great fear. So he got into a boat and returned. The man, though, from whom the demons had gone, begged that he might stay with him. But Jesus sent him home, saying, "Return to your home and declare how much God has done for you." So the man went away, proclaiming throughout the city how much Jesus had done for him. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. A couple of weeks ago that we'd spend some time in Acts. This week, though, this Luke passage was, I think, just too good to pass up. It was almost too perfect, maybe, for the things that we have been talking about the last few weeks to pass up. And hey, you know, Luke and Acts, Luke is part one, Acts is part two. So consider this Acts part one from the eighth chapter. So I've got two stories for you today, and I'm going to call this A Tale of Two Congregations. A Tale of Two Congregations. So the first congregation, let's call them the congregation of the Gerasenes. Now, the Gerasenes were people just on the other side of where Jesus was doing his ministry with his disciples. And they were I would imagine that they were maybe a tight-knit community. They were a congregation that gathered together and maybe didn't all serve in the same congregation, but they were a community. They cared about each other. And there was one member of their community who was quite disruptive. And was even so disruptive as to be a danger to himself and to others, so much so that he had to be restrained for the good of him, for his own good, and for the good of the whole congregation. He was gripped by something, whether physical or spiritual, that was beyond their understanding and beyond their control. And they wished for this man over a long period of time that he might be healed, that he might no longer have this power over him, that he couldn't control, that none of them could control. Well, one day there showed up a man who was working on behalf of God. And they found out that afternoon that God had done something for that man. And this moment was so powerful that they had to say, this must have been God doing this. It must have been God working through this man. And that power was so big, so powerful, that it was even frightening. And so they reacted with fear, and they said to the man who had done something amazing, they said, "Leave us, go away from us. We can't handle this power here." That's congregation number one, the congregation of the Gerasenes, which is recorded in the Gospel of Luke. Congregation number two was the congregation of a 19th century disciple of Jesus who lived in Germany. And this person, this disciple's name was the Elder Neumhart. And I'm hearing this story, I think, third hand. This was in a book and then written about another book. And then I heard it in a conversation on a podcast. So if I mess up a few details, that may be why. In this congregation, in about 150 years ago in Germany, there was a young woman who was beset by something that made her disruptive. So disruptive as to be dangerous to herself and to her congregation. She was gripped by something that was beyond her control and beyond anyone's understanding. And this congregation of disciples wanted nothing more than for her to be healed. So they prayed for her. For a year and a half, they prayed for her that she might be healed of this possession. And after a year and a half, there came this moment when the congregation was gathered and they had been praying for her. And then out came a voice that said, "Jesus is victor." And she was healed. And the congregation had to say, they had no choice but to say, "This must have been an act of God. Jesus is victor." And this act of God was so powerful that it was exciting for them. It increased their faith and it led them to say, "Jesus Christ is victor." That became their watchword. The thing that shaped their whole life as a congregation was this moment with this young woman whom they had prayed for a year and a half and who was healed by the grace and the power of God. And this story shaped them as they responded to it, not in fear, but in faith. So I've got a question for you. By raising of hands, has anyone ever had an experience that they would consider, experience something like an exorcism or a demonic possession that you've seen in someone else? Has anyone ever experienced something that they would say, "For sure, yes, that was something demonic"? I hear whispering over here. Okay, so I don't see any hands. So I've got another question for you. By raising the hands. How many of you have been impacted by the love and the grace and the power of Jesus in some way? By raising the hand. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about the gospel in translation. That the Holy Spirit helps us to translate the gospel from what it has been into what our culture needs it to be today. And last week, we talked about what that language today might be. Language of discipleship rather than membership. But today, this story, I think, tells us a little bit about what we're supposed to do about all that. And I think it tells us that we are called to be faithful and to watch for God. Because I believe that the God who was active in the congregation of the Gerasenes, and the God who was active in the congregation of Elder Neumhart 150 years ago, that God is active today. That God is working in our congregation. And that God is working in Carlton and Renshaw and Scanlon and Fond du Lac and Esco and Cloquet. ago is still active today. And our job is to be witnesses to what God is doing. To look and to listen and to tell about what God is working on right now. It may not look like an exorcism. In fact, given the experience of all of us here today, it probably won't. And yet, that same God is at work right now. So it's our job to see it and to tell each other about what God might be up to. Maybe in our homes, in our relationships with our fathers, perhaps, or our relationships with our family or friends. Perhaps in the places we work or spend our time. Our Carlton school. Who knows what the future will hold for our schools here in Carlton and at ESCO and other places too. Who knows what the future will hold? But I can promise you this. God will be at work. Our nursing home, too. They're having a lot of trouble getting staff and caring for the people that are there. But there are so many wonderful people there who have been disciples and who are disciples to one another. And no matter what is happening and is going to happen at IFC or at any of our other care centers around here, God's going to be at work there too. And a couple weeks ago, maybe a week and a half ago, I got the chance to go to a city council meeting here in Carlton. There were 7 people there. It was 3 council members, 3 people who worked there, who worked in the city, and me. But God showed up. God was there too. There was one person who came in a few minutes late, who is the director of something called Positive Community Norms. And they've just gotten a grant for our whole county. And this person is going to be working in Carlton on behalf of our students to help us know the good that is happening, to help us name and tell the stories of the good things that are happening. God is at work here. So, our job as disciples, as people who have seen, who just raised our hands, as people who have seen the work of Jesus in our own lives, our job is to be witnesses and to tell that story, to tell it faithfully and without fear, because we know that God has been at work in our lives, and God is still at work here and all over the place. Thanks be to God. Let us confess our faith together in the words of the Creed.
We believe in God, the maker of creation, the giver of life, whose mercy is endless, whose presence is eternal. We believe in God, who through Abraham and Sarah promised to bless all nations, who through Israel enacted the promise of blessing and freedom, who through the prophets renewed this promise, and who through Jesus the Christ, who in word and deed proclaims the presence of God, and whose death and resurrection is our example and our faith, declared the age of forgiveness and hope. We believe in God, who sends us the Holy Spirit of Christ, the promise of new life, whose communion we receive with hungry hearts, and whose love we are willing to share with those of every land, in every time, in every place. Amen.
United in Christ and guided by the Spirit, we pray for the church, world, and all those who need it. God of creation, you hear the cries of this earth. Restore places where land, air, or water rays have been harmed. Guide us to develop and implement sources of care and life for all of your creation. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of justice and healing, you hear the cries of those who are marginalized or cast out. On this Juneteenth observance, we pray for an end to modern-day slavery. We ask you also to guide your people continually toward the end of oppression in all its forms, especially white supremacy. Bring freedom and flourishing to all your beloved children. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of comfort, you hear the cries of all who suffer. Come to the aid of all who are hungry, sick, homeless, or naked. We pray especially for those in our congregation and community facing surgery or new diagnoses this week. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of love, we thank you for the fathers and the father figures in our life. And we hear the joy of those who celebrate on this day. Nurture mutual love and tender care in our families and in all our relationships. And comfort those for whom this day might bring sadness or longing. God of peace,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for the faithful departed whose lives proclaimed all you had done for them, O God. This week we especially remember and commemorate the martyrs of the Emmanuel Nine. At the last, unite us with all your saints as we make our home in you. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of every time and place, in Jesus' name, you filled us with your Holy Spirit. We entrust these spoken prayers and those in our hearts into your holy keeping. Amen. As we share the peace of Christ, remember that you can share the peace with a handshake, a hug, or if you prefer not to contact one another, place your hand over your heart and share the peace with one another. May the peace of Christ be with you all. Please share with one another.
Thank you. philosopher, and you, O God, maker of all things, creator of gifts, and of us as the easiest, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us from what you have gathered in feeding the world with your love, through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
May God be with you, friends,
and with you once again.
Lift up your heart and mind.
We lift them up in kind.
Let us thank our God who lives.
Thanks and praises what we have to
in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Today we commune, as has been our practice, by coming forward, receiving a piece of gluten-free bread, and going to either side to receive the cup. The purple is wine, and the white is grape juice, and return the cup to the holder on each side. Know today that all are welcome, for all that is required from us is a heart that desires God. So come knowing that you are welcome here. Come, for all is now ready and all are welcome.
Who takes our bread and the
us in the spirit of your love, O God, and unite the wills of those whom you have fed with life-giving food, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Children of God and witnesses to the love and power of Jesus, receive this blessing. The Lord will bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and with mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Serve the living God.
Thanks.